Hello everyone, and good morning or evening as the case may be. I'm Andrew Lavergetta, Public Service Specialist at Eckhart Public Library in Auburn, Indiana. Today I'm going to be going over the very basics of setting up a Discord server to help you with your library, your community, and hopefully just aid in programming while social distancing during COVID-19. First of all, what is Discord? As it says here, it's your place to talk. It is a free service. It was primarily made for gamers. Of course, 13 and up was the age limit for it. It helps people organize and get a game going over some other service, like if they're using an Xbox or a PC game. You can also imagine it's like a group phone call or maybe one of those old party lines, depending upon what generation you're from. It's a service for voice chat, but it also incorporates text chat. It's something that is generally always left on. People always stay logged into it for the most part, and the only time that you disconnect is usually when you turn off your computer or that kind of thing. But you can choose what you want to do because it's always there, it's always available. Secondly, how can I use Discord to aid to my library? Anytime that you want to communicate or speak with somebody, one or more people, you want to get a message out and you aren't able to or you can't do it in person, Discord can play a part. As I mentioned, it's a perpetual message board and a chat room where users can message a group and tag other people to get their attention. So let's say that I am going to be doing something soon coming up in the programming voice chat down here. This is Discord here, by the way. If I'm in programming here, I can say here at, let's say teen patron. Oops, teen. At teen patron. And then I can say, Magic the Gathering game coming up soon. And I would send that. And then everybody who is a teen patron will get a notification saying that that's coming up. I mentioned Magic the Gathering because that's one of my programs that I do. So then we could say, oh, hey, cool, they're going to be playing Magic the Gathering. We can come into the teens chat room here and we can talk about the game that's going on. So that's something that you can do. Leave voice chat. All right. So the voice chat feature can, like I said, can be imagined as a voice call that's always left open or a party line. Just click on the voice chat channel and join a call and hear the conversation that's going on or talk to the group. When I'm in this chat channel, anything that I say will be picked up by my microphone and the other users in that channel can hear. It's also possible to set your microphone to only work when you use a push to talk button that you can set up yourself. So you could make it so that whenever you hold down the A key, is when you'll talk. So if, let's say, a group wants to have a book club, they want to discuss a book, or they want to plan for a programming group, they can join a certain text channel for it. They could talk about it, they can type ideas back and forth, and then later on they can join the voice channel and they can actually talk about it and have like a real-time meeting or something like that. It's similar to a Zoom call, if you want to think about it that way, but it's just without the video. Recently, our library started talking about setting up a Dungeons & Dragons club. So that's something that we can do over one of the voice channels here. We can plan when we're going to meet over the text channel and then join the voice channel when we're actually playing the game. And then we can use an outside website like Roll20.net or a virtual tabletop simulator on the computer. And then we can do our online adventures that way. You can also have a voice chat on Discord, and you can mute everybody except for certain people. So if you're going to have like an announcement or something like that, you can invite everybody to come on and listen to it, but then you can make it so that the only person who can be heard is the presenter. It's possible to stream live video over a channel in Discord. That's a newer feature that I'm not as versed on. I know that you can get better video quality by it by paying. That's one of the few things that you do get a bonus by having a paid service, but it's definitely not necessary. You can also use something like Facebook or YouTube to go live, but then you can also have integrated into Discord a way to tell people when you're going live on those services. Now, how do you set up your own server? First, obviously, you need to have your own username, your own account. You get into Discord either by the browser or by an app, and then you click on the Add a Server button. So you would click Add. You can either join a server that's existing, but we want to create a new server. You can type in make up the name for it. Right now this just says ES for EPL Andrews server, but I'm going to say demo server, or I can just say D space E slash M space O and click create. So this is what a new server looks like when it comes out. It gives you a link to it so you can invite friends to your Discord server. It says your invite link expires in 1 day, and then you can edit that to last for longer or shorter. I'm going to close that. So it looks like this here when you start out. You can add more chat channels, text channels, you can add more voice channels, you can add custom channels. One of the best ways to figure out what you can do with your Discord server is to join other servers. Now, something that I do want to focus on is that customization, and especially the safety that you can get with that customization. In order for somebody to join your server, first of all, they need to click on a link, on an invitation link they usually get from somebody else. It's in the form of discord.gg and then some other collection of numbers and letters. Like I said, they usually expire after about a day or so, but you can set those links to never expire. That can be a good way to help control who comes into your server, but generally people that are already on the server can get a link to other people. They can make their own link for that, but then you can also set it to only have certain roles be able to make new links for people. If you want, Discord can just be a wide open sandbox for anybody to be able to do anything. Usually in a group of friends you have a server, you just let anybody be able to do anything. But for something like this, for like a library Discord server, you want to keep it locked down pretty tight for the most part. So I'm going to go back to the one that I made for our library. I'm going to click on this drop-down menu where it says the library server name. I'm going to go to server settings. And then I'm going to go down to roles, because you can create roles that you can assign people to. So I can assign different users to the admin, to the staff, teens. I can give them the teen patron role. And then everybody else, just general people, those are going to be patrons. There are me6 and bot here, because those are just automation services that are available for Discord. But the general person who's going to be in the server who doesn't have any special privileges is just the patron. I'll talk about teen patron here in a second and see how they're different. But if I click on patron here, for example, everything that's checked off here are things that they are not allowed to do. But on the right side, for example, they can create invites, they can change their own nickname, they can read text channels, and they can see voice channels generally. They can send messages. They cannot embed links. They cannot attach files. They cannot manage messages, so they can't delete messages by other members or pin any message. We don't want, you know, too much permission given to just the general people that are here, because we just want them to be able to talk and see. They can connect to the voice channels. They can speak in the voice channels. They can't share videos. They can't mute other members. They can't deafen other members. They can't move other members into other channels or out of channels. So again, it's just keeping the server friendly to everybody. Now, teen patrons. One of the things with teen patrons is that when they join the channel, if they let us know, we will promote them to teen patron. One of the interesting things is that these channels, the text channels for EPL teens and two, and the voice channels for the same ones, are only visible by teen patrons and higher permissions. So that means that just the general person coming into the channel can't join a chat with the teens and listen in on whatever they're talking about. They can't go in here and listen to whatever the teens are talking about, or read what the teens are talking about in their channel there. Obviously the staff can, again. Just like we have our teen library that is intended as a safe space for teens, we want to have a safe space here for teens in the Discord as well. Now, I have talked about bots already. I have talked about the patron level. When people come in, they don't have any role at all. But if you go to, if you Google me6, M-E-E-6, you can actually find how you can add the me6 bot. The me6 bot is one of the things that welcomes people. Me6 also automatically promotes people to patron level. So that means that they have just those blanket, those bottom privileges instead of no privileges at all. And then to wrap up the remaining channels that I haven't mentioned, welcome, rules, announcements, EPL programs, those can only be typed in by EPL staff and admins. I can go down here further. Library staff channels for text and for voice are only visible and accessible by the staff and higher. The AFK channel down here, if you're in the voice channel for too long, again, it'll just put you into the AFK channel. And the AFK channel down here, that's just where you go after a certain amount of inactivity in the other voice channels. It just kind of declutters the area and just keeps it separate. Nobody can hear or speak in the AFK channel. So what else can Discord do? You actually don't even need to join the server to use Discord. If you have someone else's username and tag, you can request to add them as a friend and send them private messages. You can also start a voice call with that person or a group chat, and then you can also add a video with those people if you'd like. There are also several public Discord servers on certain popular topics. If I go down here to the compass, you can see everything from gaming topics, everything down to movies and TV, so I could join a Star Wars one. Interesting thing is that you can only see these pages here until you go to another part here where it tells about how to join other stuff. Guidelines. Different bot setups and things. You can see everybody who's in this channel. There are a lot of people in this channel. So that's a public Discord channel. I'm not going to go into that right now. I'm just going to stay in our own channel. Some of the Discord servers I have joined in the past include servers that are used in games like World of Warcraft or things like that. You can have coordination for things that you're doing in-game. YouTube channels have cultivated their own communities on their own Discord channels. A group of my friends were going to be meeting a few summers ago, coming from different states and from different countries, actually. So we set up our own Discord server so we could plan the get-together. And then even Pokemon Go players have local Discord servers where they can plan where they're going, where they're going to walk, where they're going to drive, in order to complete their objectives that require multiple people in a timely manner. So again, anytime that you'd like to communicate with people, that you're wanting to get a following, that you want to get the word out, that you want to do something that you can't usually or aren't usually doing in person, that's a good opportunity to use Discord. I hope that this helps you out. If you have questions, I'm sure I can be reached in some manner. I'll have my email address someplace. And then also just use YouTube, use Google, search YouTube for setting up a Discord server. And then they will be able to, or you'll be able to find what you need there. I hope this video has been of some help to you. If you need help beyond just what I've done here so far, go to Google, go to YouTube, search setting up a Discord server. The person who I referenced for a lot of my information that I found is named Gesture on YouTube. I think it's spelled G-E-H-S-T-U-R-E or something along those lines. He's got a really good video. It's about 20 to 30 minutes long, but it covers pretty much everything that you need and some things that you don't need. Like these little emojis on the side of each channel. That's not a usual thing. But yeah, hope you can find everything that you need for Discord. Get it set up, get it helping your community. Thanks.